the body really rewards you in terms of if you wait or if you don't eat right before bed, is it going to sleep better, sleep deeper, be cooler, and therefore help you have more energy the next day if you don't eat before bed?
Yeah, and this has, at least for me, been most easy to exhibit. And I think many of my patients would agree during periods of fasting. So fasting is kind of a funky state because you're altering so many other things in the physiology. But one of the things that happens, especially by about the second day of a water-only fast, is you really are seeing the impacts of what deep sleep can look like in a state that is totally absent food. And it's very interesting because you're competing with two forces, one that's keeping you awake and one that's helping you sleep a lot deeper. The one that's keeping you awake is cortisol. You have more of it. You have more stress hormones when you're fasting because that's the thing from a prehistoric standpoint that would have been going on, right? Fasting would trigger a signal that says, go get more food, right?
Be
So
alert, be
be
focused, like,
alert, go get food. Like, we don't want to die. And so that's kind of keeping you awake. But the flip side of that is, the total absence of nutrient is allowing you to get into this amazing sleep, and your body temperature is really going down because your body's turning down its metabolism. So I actually find fasting sleep to be some of the most amazing physiology because I'm watching this plummeting temperature, rising heart rate variability, falling heart rate, all of these really valuable things, but a little bit of rising cortisol that can lead to shorter sleep times. But I still feel quite, rejuvenated by sleep.
Wow. Okay. I want to stay on sleep for a second. I know you got the fourth one, which I want to close that loop, but do we does that hurt us if we nap throughout the day or take a power nap for 20 to 40 minutes? Does that help our bodies recover more, even if we're doing the 7 or 8 hours of sleep, or does that not matter?
It depends. I would say naps are not a bad idea, provided they don't reduce your drive to sleep later. So I just got back from like a hunting trip last month where just based, I mean, first of all, it was exhausting, right? You're sort of hiking 10 or 11 miles a day on vertical walls, carrying a 50-pound pack. It's all the stuff that is physiologically as taxing as it gets at altitude, right? So there was no way you could go to bed like any earlier than 11, and you had to be up by 4:30.
Really?
Well, just because you have the most the two times when you're going to have the best opportunity to go and stalk the animal is in the evening and in the morning. So those are the times. So there was no way I was going to survive a week of that if I didn't carve out an hour and a half to 2 hours in the middle of day in the day to sleep. And I'm normally not a napper, but I made it a priority above anything else, including practicing, with my bow and arrow in the middle of the day, which I would normally want to do. Nothing was a higher priority than getting that nap in during the day because I was deficient at night, and getting that nap in the day didn't rob me of the ability to sleep at night.
Right. You still were passing out right when you got in your pillow.
Absolutely. Now let's say we talk about a person who is getting 7.5 or 8 hours of quality sleep at night. Is there any downside to a 20-minute power nap? I would say no. But if going any longer than that, I would be mindful of it because, sleep comes down to balancing basically three things. The first is cortisol. So the stress hormone cortisol must decline in the evening for you to be able to sleep. The second thing is you have to accumulate something called adenosine. So adenosine is kind of like this metabolic breakdown product that is corresponds to how much work we do, physical work, cognitive work. So more adenosine makes us more tired. That's how caffeine works, by the way. Caffeine blocks the adenosine receptor. So it functionally makes you think you have less adenosine, and napping reduces adenosine. So you just want to make sure you don't reduce it too much. The third is melatonin, by the way, which has to go up. So good sleep is when melatonin and adenosine go up and cortisol comes down. So I guess to close that out, I would say if you are sleeping so short during the middle of the day, and this is what I was thinking about on my trip, you want to try to replicate a full sleep cycle in your nap, which is about 90 minutes. So that's why I really said, look, I'm going to set aside 2 hours to take a nap in the middle of the day to give me one full sleep cycle because I'm clearly being deprived of one during the nighttime.
And is there a such a thing as too much sleep? If you're getting 10, 12, 14 hours of sleep every day consistently, is that does that affect the body in a negative way?
Really an interesting question, by the way, and quite a controversial question in the sleep literature. So there is no question that hypersleep has been associated with poor outcomes. So, you know, there's a U-shaped curve of mortality with sleep, right? So people who don't get much sleep have a higher mortality, and it's really more of a J curve, right? So they kind of, you know, as you get more and more sleep, the mortality comes down, 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 but then it does sort of uptick. So you get these people who are sleeping a lot and they're actually having worse outcomes than the people that are in the 7.5 to 9 range. Historically, that has been explained by the fact that people who are sleeping a lot are usually sick, and that's why they're sleeping a lot. So we got the arrow of causation wrong. We're saying, you know, are they sick because they're sleeping too much, or are they sleeping too much because they're sick?
Right.
While I think that the majority of the hypersleepers are hypersleepers because they are sick, there is actually some emerging evidence to suggest that absent that, there might be a downside in too much sleep. But again, I think for most people, most of us are on the other end of that spectrum, which is we're constantly battling the need to get enough. And that's either through, you know, our kids, our work, our stress, our electronics,
yeah,
our food, our alcohol, you know, all of the above, our travel. Yeah.
And is it a negative if you're a kid and you're eating a lot of junk food, you're not sleeping, you're staying up late because you're whatever, playing video games all night, but you've got all this energy all day and you're active. Is there a negative in your early ages, teens, early 20s, through lacking sleep, eating poorly? Or is there a way to recover in your 20s from the damage you've done in your before 20?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, certainly you can break it down into sort of the behavioral habit side, and you can talk about it through the physiologic lens. The good news is before the age of 20 or 30, we are pretty remarkably resilient. I mean, you're an athlete, so you can relate. How old are you now, Lewis? You're in your
37.
So you might not have fully appreciated, I'm 47, so I'm a full decade older than you. And when I think about 17 to 27 to 37 to 47, I can really talk about those decades through the lens of resilience. Mm-hmm. Like at 17, you could shoot me and I think I'd still get up the next day. Right. Like you just couldn't, right?
You're Superman. Yeah.
You're absolutely Superman. And I don't know. I feel like the first observation of not being Superman for me kind of kicked in about 42-ish, about five years ago. Was the first time I was like, oh, so this is what people talk about, right? Like you can't just go out and crush it every minute of every day. And I think that's just one lens, which is through the lens of exercise. But the same is true of physiology, right? Like, or I'll give you another example. Many of my patients have observed this. I've observed this. Like I was never a big drinker in college, but certainly there were enough occasions in med school or college where I'd go out and drink far more than anyone should. And yet somehow the next day I could like get up at 6 a.m. and go and do whatever I need to do. Like I remember one night actually being out drinking until 3 a.m. I mean, having so much to drink, it was ridiculous. And somehow getting up at 6 a.m. to do a 100-mile bike ride.
Oh my gosh, man.
Probably still partially drunk. But felt fine by about like 2 hours into the ride. Today, if I had 3 glasses of wine, like the headache I'm going to have the next day is going to last me till the middle of the day.
Is that because your body was able to assimilate the glucose into the muscles and it used it to its advantage then? And now it's like, it takes over.
It's a very good question. I could sort of, you know, speculate on what it is, but I just think there's there's this thing called homeostasis, right? Which is one of the hallmarks of youth. And it's one of the hallmarks of aging. And, you know, it's the ability to, or it's our lack of homeostasis. We lose this ability to get the body back into the zone of optimal performance. So everything about the human body is very particular. For example, take pH, which is the amount of acidity in our body. We're so highly regulated, like our body really needs to be at a pH of 7.4. So 7 would kill you and 7.6 or 7.7 would kill you. And this is a scale that goes from 0 to 14, to put that in perspective.
Wow. Okay,
so tiny perturbations will kill you. How good is our body at staying in that? Amazing. Temperature, right? You go much below about 94, you're dead. You go much above about 104, you're dead. How good are we at staying in that range? Oh, I mean good. I mean, we generally stay within a 1.5 degree band. So this homeostasis thing is amazing. It gets weaker and weaker as we get older. And so your ability to tolerate bad food, bad sleep, sedentary behavior, more stress, all those things, it just gets weaker and weaker and weaker. And I think it declines non-linearly. So again, what you experience as a decline between 30 and 40, it's bad. 40 to 50, yeah, that's worse. 50 to 60, you can fall off a cliff.
Is there a way to reverse this?
I don't think we know. I think you can definitely slow the progression of it. And you know what? I would say you probably can reverse it, right? So just as you can clearly reverse diabetes, diabetes is a glucose homeostasis problem, and it's clearly reversible. You know, so there are probably some variants of this that are harder to reverse than others. But I think we can reverse this process. But it gets harder. You know, it gets harder as time goes on, and it gets harder the further you are into, you know, sort of the physiologic trap.
What are you doing to reverse it now that you've been experiencing this kind of not maybe a cliff, but a dip over the last 5 years for yourself? How are you thinking about it?
Well, I sort of had a change of heart 5 years ago. So actually 6 years ago, 2014. So I sort of hung up my bike, which at that point I'd switched from swimming to cycling as sort of my main sport. But I, you know, at that point, a couple of things had happened. So one, I had become very familiar with a lot of emerging research on excessive cardiovascular training, which again is a rich man's problem.
Ultra marathons, ultra biking, ultra swimming, hiking.
That's right. So I'd be, again, very, and it's the same sort of curve, right? Where as exercise, dose of exercise goes up, mortality comes down, but it has this little bit of a J where once you start to get into hyper amounts of exercise, especially over the age of 40, you're actually driving an increase in mortality. Now, again,
really?
Yes.
Does that mean running a marathon once a year? Or is it running a marathon every week?
Yeah, great point. Running a marathon once a year, probably not increasing your mortality at all. But, you know, running 40, 50 miles a week probably is.
Wow,
especially at that age. Now, again, this gets to your point about resilience. Someone in their 20s doing that doesn't seem to have any impact on mortality. It really only seems to be an issue if you continue. In fact, I did an interview with a cardiologist, James O'Keefe, on my podcast, who is, you know, the world's expert on this. And it was actually James's work 6 years ago, because I heard him speak at a conference 10 years ago. We became friends. It's one of those things, I'm sure you've experienced this, where you hear something and you don't want it to be true. So you basically come up with all the reasons you're going to poke holes in it until you can't anymore.
You find the evidence the other way. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And eventually it became very difficult to ignore that this hyper amount of exercise was counterproductive. So that's one piece of the change 6 years ago.
It's probably bad that I just committed to doing the marathon next year yesterday.
That's all right though. You'll be fine. I just think don't do one a month.
You know? Exactly.
And then I think the second thing was I realized, like, it was sort of funny, but I realized like my prime was so far behind me that I needed to think about like, what was I doing this in service of, right? Like, and not that I needed anyone other than myself to do these things, because I'm very self-motivated. So I don't like, but just as a joke, one day I asked my wife, I said, "Hey, do you know what my PR is for 20K?
Like bike, run, or swim?"
Yeah, bike on a 20K bike on the time trial. And I was like, this is my wife. She hears me talk about this stuff all the time. I have spreadsheets and models and data, and I analyze my power data every single day. And I'm trying to break the record for San Diego. Like, I'm really so switched on to this. She'll probably get it within a minute. She'll guess what my PR is within a minute. She was off by 20 minutes, meaning she wasn't even in the zip code. So I was like, huh, that's funny. Like, it's like literally the most important person in my life couldn't care less about this. And what I realized was, you know, I need to start thinking about a different sport, which is the sport of longevity. So what does it mean to be a kick-ass 100-year-old? And so that was the beginning of a mental model for me that in the past 2 years has gained much more traction, called the Centenarian Olympics. So how do you train to kick ass at 100 should you get there? And of course, everywhere along the way. So that now dominates my landscape of training, which means I don't, you know, care about how fast I can, you know, ride a 40 kilometer time trial, because that doesn't quite fit into what a centenarian needs to be able to do.
What is your mindset going into a 40 mile bike then, or some type of experience? Is it more the joy of it?
I don't train. No, my training is very specific, but now it is fundamentally organized around four pillars. So the pillars being stability, strength, mitochondrial or aerobic efficiency, and anaerobic performance. And so each of those then has a super layer detail approach. And I still ride my bike 4 hours a week. So it's a fraction of what I used to do. And it's now very much geared to a certain energy system and a type of training.
What was the fourth one? Stability, strength, mitochondria, and
mitochondrial efficiency or aerobic efficiency. And then the fourth and final one is anaerobic performance.
So you focus on those four metrics now on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah. Yeah. Those four pillars sort of make up the training program, which is then in service of something that I invite every patient to define for themselves, which is, because you will have a different, you know, set of variables for me potentially, but you know, my centenarian Olympics has, you know, 18 events in it. You know, like I want to be able to pull myself out of a pool that, you know, where there's a 1 foot gap between the water and the curb, like lift myself up. I want to be able to hop over a 3 foot fence. I want to be able to walk 3 miles in an hour. I want to be able to carry 2 10-pound bags up 4 flights of stairs. I want to be able to goblet squat 30 pounds because that's about the weight of a kid. I want to be able to get up off the floor without using my hands. So I could rattle off all of my 18 things and you would say, Peter, those seem really easy. And you'd be right as a 37-year-old stud. But the point is,
as a 60-year-old, a lot of them aren't easy.
Most 60-year-olds couldn't do this if their life depended on it. And I have yet to meet but maybe one person in their 80s or 90s who can. And so that's the aspiration, is to get to that level in your 80s or 90s. How do you work that backwards to inform your training in your 60s, in your 50s, and in your 40s? And it's actually very hard.
And as I'm getting into, you know, I'm 3 years away from 40, what should someone in my age range be thinking about when they're, you know, I'm healthy, I feel good, you know, maybe have some aches and pains here and there when I'm training hard or something, but for the most part, I feel amazing. What should I be thinking about moving forward so that I continue to feel amazing and have the ability to do these things?
So I think it's never too late to at least become familiar with what these ideas mean. And it doesn't mean that you have to go whole hog and devote yourself to this. Like, I've obviously made a very conscious choice that I don't go to swim meets. I don't go to bike races. Like, I don't train for those things anymore. And a big part of that is just time. You know, there are only 168 hours in a week, and, you know, I have a very clear set of priorities, and I'm willing to set aside 10 to 12 hours a week for exercise, which by many people's standards is still quite a lot, but probably by the standards that you exercise and certainly by the standards that I used to exercise, you know, I've never exercised so little in my life. So I have to be very efficient with every one of those minutes. And that means I'm laser focused on the four principles of that. In your case, I think it comes down to saying, okay, how much time do you want to devote to the long game? How much time do you want to devote to the short game? Another way to think about this would be investing. If you're looking at an investment portfolio, you might say, how much do I want to put both time and money, so the actual capital I set aside, but also the amount of time I spend deliberating over it, into my retirement account, versus how much do I want to invest as a day trader for short-term gains, for, you know, money that I'm going to be using in the near term that's maybe even supplementing my income today. Mm-hmm. You could have totally different strategies for that, and that's totally fine. So I'm just in the category where I'm only thinking about long-term permanent capital. Right. And so so that's the first question, is you have to decide, how do you want to do that? And it might be that you say, you know, Peter, at 37, I just want to focus on running a marathon. I've always wanted to do an Ironman, so I'm going to go and do that. And, you know, I want to climb Mount Everest, and that's going to require, like, you might have a whole bunch of these bucket list things. And truthfully, right, I would say do them now, because it's only going to get harder.
Because you're not going to be able to do it later. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think you're going to want to do it later. So get those things out of the way.
Yeah.
And then maybe when you turn 40, you say, okay, now it's time I'm going to really focus on my centenarian Olympics when I have a better sense of what those events look like for me personally. If you are sleeping so short during the middle of the day, and this is what I was thinking about on my trip, you want to try to replicate a full sleep cycle in your nap, which is about 90 minutes. Mm. So that's why I really said, look, I'm going to set aside 2 hours to take a nap in the middle of the day.